Hello students, hope you are doing good. In the first video, you learned about few concepts of the lesson water. You will be learning few more concepts in this video. In this video, according to the scope of syllabus, you will be learning about efflorescent, deliquescent and hygroscopic substances and also examples for the same. You will be learning about drying and dehydrating agent with examples. You'll also learn few concepts of hard and soft water. We will learn about the three substances, efflorescent, deliquescent and hygroscopic substances in a little more detail. I have written it in the form of a table so that the comparative study will help you to understand better and retain in your memory for a longer time. We know that the efflorescent substances are crystalline hydrated salts. They are solids, they are crystalline hydrated salts. Deliquescent substances are water soluble salts, they are also crystalline solids. That means they absorb moisture. Hygroscopic substances are amorphous, that is fine powder. They are either solids or liquids. If they are solids, they are amorphous solids or they are liquids. Now these efflorescent substances, when exposed to atmosphere, they lose moisture. Whereas deliquescent substance, they absorb moisture on exposure to atmosphere. Even hygroscopic substances, they absorb moisture on exposure to atmosphere. Now we have both as the same here. Let us see how they differ in the next point. These efflorescent substances, which are crystalline, which lose moisture on exposure to atmosphere, change into amorphous state. That means they become a fine powder. Crystalline becomes amorphous. Whereas deliquescent substances, they are water soluble salts and hence they absorb moisture and they change into a liquid state, or you can say they change into a saturated solution. Whereas hygroscopic substances, just like deliquescent substances, they absorb moisture on exposure to the atmosphere, but they do not change their state. Solid remains solid, liquid remains liquid. Now, these three substances, they undergo a phenomenon when they are exposed to the atmosphere. Now here, efflorescent substances, they undergo a phenomenon called as efflorescence. Remember, phenomenon is efflorescent, substance is efflorescent substance. In the similar way, deliquescent is the substance and this substance undergoes a phenomenon called as deliquescence. In the similar way, hygroscopic substances also undergo a phenomenon which you do not have according to the scope, and that is nothing but hygroscopy. Now coming to the examples for all of these, we have sodium carbonate, decahydrate or washing soda as an example for efflorescent salts, and these on exposure to the atmosphere change into a residue, and that is sodium carbonate monohydrate. That means it loses 9 molecules of water. Whereas copper 2 sulfate pentahydrate, which on exposure to moisture loses the water of crystallization and becomes copper 2 sulfate, which is copper 2 sulfate pentahydrate is commonly called as blue vitriol, which you have already learned. Sodium sulfate decahydrate, commonly called as globular salt, also loses the 10 molecules of water or water of crystallization and becomes sodium sulfate. Now we have examples for deliquescent substances. We have these three chlorides: iron 3 chloride, calcium chloride, magnesium chloride. We also have sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide as examples. Now iron 3 chloride or ferric chloride is a very important example because this is the most likely question that is asked in the board exam. They'll ask you name a deliquescent substance which is trivalent, because the valency of only iron in the 3 is 3, and hence remember ferric chloride as an example of a deliquescent substance with valency 3 or a trivalent example. Now we have hygroscopic substances, examples for the same. There are solids which act as hygroscopic substances. You know these are amorphous solids, and that is calcium oxide, also called as quicklime, anhydrous calcium chloride, silica gel, which is very important. You know, you have seen silica gel packets in the packaging that you get for when you buy footwear or leather bags. Now you find in these boxes silica gel packets, and these absorb moisture and hence they are placed in this packaging material, and they prevent the materials from getting attacked by the fungus. Now we have only one liquid as a hygroscopic substances to remember, and that is concentrated sulfuric acid. According to the scope of syllabus, learn the meaning of all the three substances and the examples well. Now we will learn about the drying agents and the dehydrating agents and the difference between the two. Drying agents are nothing but the hygroscopic substances. They remove moisture from substances. Now what they do is they only remove moisture and do not change the chemical composition of the substance. Like how when you hang wet clothes, the water is evaporated and no chemical composition of the cloth is changed. So whatever examples you learn for hygroscopic substances, the same example you learn for drying agents. Concentrated sulfuric acid, fused phosphorus pentoxide, calcium oxide, and anhydrous calcium chloride. Anhydrous calcium chloride, when kept in a desiccator, it acts as a desiccating agent. It removes moisture in a desiccator, and hence it is both a drying and a desiccating agent. Whereas when we talk about the dehydrating agents, they remove chemically combined water from substances. What they do is the chemical elements of water, that is hydrogen and oxygen, is removed from the substances when it is passed through a dehydrating agent or when a dehydrating agent is added to it. Let us take an example, glucose. When concentrated sulfuric acid is added to glucose, concentrated sulfuric acid, being a dehydrating agent, removes chemical elements of water, that is hydrogen and oxygen, from glucose, and what remains behind is carbon. Carbon remains as a black spongy mass, and 6 molecules of water is removed or absorbed, you can say. Now here we know that the chemical elements are removed and hence the chemical composition also changes. The same thing happens when concentrated sulfuric acid is added to sawdust. The chemical elements of water, that is hydrogen and oxygen, is also removed from sawdust, and what remains there also is a black spongy mass of carbon. Now you have to remember concentrated sulfuric acid. It is very important because it plays many roles. It acts as a hygroscopic substance, it acts as a drying agent, it also acts as a dehydrating agent. Learn the meaning of the two, and with that you can differentiate between drying agent and dehydrating agent, and also learn the examples well. Now let us learn the next concept of water. Now water is classified into two types based on its action with soap. Now we have soft water based on the action with soap, and we also have hard water. Now what do we mean by soft water? What do we mean by hard water? If the water lathers readily with soap, if it lathers readily with ordinary soap, then we call such a water as soft water. If the water does not lather with ordinary soap, then we call such a water as hard water. So because it lathers readily with soap, this soft water does not waste soap. Does not waste soap. Whereas hard water, it doesn't lather readily with soap, and hence it wastes soap. Now, when we talk about soft water, the sources from which we obtain soft water is the distilled water or the rain water. These are the sources from which we obtain the soft water. Whereas hard water we get from the natural water, that is from the rivers and springs. Rivers, springs, the natural water, they form the hard water. Now, what makes the water hard is the next point that we need to learn. Now, the water is hard because of the presence of salts in it. Now, which are the salts that makes the water hard? The salts that makes the water hard are bicarbonates, chlorides and sulfates. Bicarbonates, chlorides and sulfates of calcium and magnesium. Bicarbonates, chlorides and sulfates of calcium and magnesium are the salts that make the water hard. So water is hard because of the presence of these salts. Now this hard water can further be classified into two types based on the type of salts that it contains. Now here we have temporary hard water and permanent hard water. Temporary hard water and permanent hard water. Now we call water as hard water as temporary hard water because it contains the salts, namely bicarbonates of calcium and magnesium. That means calcium bicarbonate, magnesium bicarbonate. We call the water as permanent hard water because of the presence of chlorides and sulfates of calcium and magnesium. So the salts that are present here are calcium chloride, magnesium chloride, calcium sulfate, magnesium sulfate. Now this is the difference between temporary hard water and permanent hard water, and it is with respect to the salts that are present in them. A temporary hard water will have calcium bicarbonate, magnesium bicarbonate. A permanent hard water will have calcium chloride, magnesium chloride, calcium sulfate and magnesium sulfate in it. This is one difference between the temporary hard water and permanent hard water. Let us learn how to remove temporary hardness in water. We have a method to remove temporary hardness in water, and that is boiling. Now, by boiling, the carbonates precipitate out and carbon dioxide and water are formed. Now we know that temporary hardness is caused by these two salts, calcium bicarbonate, magnesium bicarbonate. Now let us learn the removal of these two with the help of equations. Now we have calcium bicarbonate, which on boiling decomposes and it forms insoluble calcium carbonate, forming carbon dioxide, which is evolved as a gas, and then water, and this water is rendered soft. So here the calcium carbonate, which is a precipitate, is removed by filtering. Carbon dioxide escapes and the water that remains is a water which is soft. Now the temporary hardness is removed. Similarly, magnesium bicarbonate, which on boiling forms magnesium carbonate, carbon dioxide and water, and this water is again rendered soft. So the magnesium carbonate is precipitated out, which is filtered, and carbon dioxide escapes as a gas and the water becomes soft. This is how we remove temporary hardness by boiling. We will now learn how to remove temporary and permanent hardness by adding one substance, and that is sodium carbonate or washing soda. Now with the help of the equations, we learn them better. When we talk about temporary hardness, we know it is due to the presence of calcium bicarbonate and magnesium bicarbonate. One reactant that is common to all the equation is sodium carbonate. And when sodium carbonate is added to temporary hard water, insoluble calcium carbonate is formed, which is precipitated out, and then soluble sodium bicarbonate is formed, and this is soluble in water and renders the water soft. Similarly, sodium carbonate, when it is added to magnesium bicarbonate, how it is removed? That is temporary hard water. Magnesium carbonate is precipitated out, it is filtered out, and what remains behind is the soluble sodium bicarbonate. And that water which contains soluble sodium bicarbonate is rendered soft. Now let us learn how to remove permanent hardness. And you know, permanent hard water is caused due to the four salts, that is calcium chloride, magnesium chloride, calcium sulfate, magnesium sulfate. Now let us add sodium carbonate to each of these in order to remove them. We know again we get insoluble calcium carbonate, which is filtered out, and then soluble sodium salt, that is sodium chloride, which is present in water and renders the water soft. The same thing for magnesium chloride. We get again magnesium carbonate as an insoluble salt, and then sodium chloride, calcium sulfate, sodium carbonate. Here we get calcium carbonate as an insoluble precipitate, and the soluble sodium salt, all sodium salts are always soluble, which is present in water and renders the water soft. Magnesium sulfate and sodium bicarbonate. Now here double decomposition. You know, in all these cases double decomposition reaction takes place. So it is insoluble magnesium carbonate plus sodium sulfate that is formed, which renders the water soft. So what are we doing here? We are removing all the insoluble salts and the water will be rendered as soft in all the cases. Learn all these equations well. They are very important from the examination point of view. Let us learn the advantages and disadvantages of soft water and hard water. The advantages of soft water is it is fit for laundries and industries, and it is good for hair and skin as it leaves the skin and hair shiny. It is good for laundries because it lathers readily with soap, industries because it doesn't form a scum. And coming to the advantages of hard water, it is a good source of calcium and magnesium. And because it is a good source of calcium and magnesium, it is good for our bones and teeth. The disadvantage of soft water is it is salty to taste because it contains only sodium ion and not the other ions. Then coming to the disadvantage of hard water, it is just the opposite of advantage of soft water, you can say. It is unfit for laundries and industries, and it as it forms a crusty boiler scale in the industries, because hard water is used to produce steam in industries, and you can take that as an advantage also for hard water. It is used in industries to produce steam, but the disadvantage is it produces a crusty boiler scale and it causes corrosion. It corrodes the metals and hence it damages the pipes. So these are some of the advantages and disadvantages of soft water and hard water. Learn them well. For assignments, you look at the description box. Thank you.